To present to you is the state of the relations with the European Union and Ukraine. As you know, some 5 years ago, the European Union, at the request of Ukraine, decided to deepen its relations with Ukraine by offering to Ukraine political association and economic integration. This can be achieved through an association agreement, which includes a deep and comprehensive free trade agreement. What does it mean in concrete terms? It means that once these negotiations are completed, Ukraine would have to start a process of transformation of its legislation in terms of making it a more predictable, transparent, and rules-based in terms of the economic relations within the country and with the European Union, as well as to consolidate what we call the European Union fundamental values in terms of democracy, human rights, freedom of speech, rule of law, those criteria that are required to be part of the European Union family. At this moment, we are negotiating this agreement. We hope to complete these negotiations by the end of this year. As I said, we started 5 years ago, roughly, first on what are considered the political aspects and the cooperation areas. And then later on, after Ukraine joined the WTO, we started the negotiations on the economic and trade components of this agreement. As you know, the start of this process came about after one event that in Ukraine is called the Orange Revolution. It means, basically, I would say it was not really a revolution. I would say it was maybe a vote of protest for an electoral process that took place in the end of 2004, which the Ukrainian people considered that was being, let's say, manipulated, and through their active demonstrations, particularly in Kiev, images that were seen throughout Europe, and that passed the message that, well, the Ukrainian people indeed are demonstrating that they want to move away from the post-Soviet legacy into wanting to share the same values and the same benefits from European Union, because those values of democracy that I have referred are considered essential for a more prosperous, sustainable, predictable economic environment, which can therefore allow also the citizens to have higher social standards. Basically, this is what every citizen expects and wishes to have. Of course, in the period of the previous leadership, Mr. Yushchenko, Mrs. Tymoshenko, Ukraine went through a process where there was a lot of quarreling between these actors. Sometimes this quarreling was even ridicularized. I think we can say that during that period, Ukraine indeed became more pluralistic. Ukraine did not change in terms of legislation, in terms of many of the problems that affect the Ukrainian society. But the fact that the powers were not in one single end, they were distributed by three players, which is the president, the government, and the parliament, made it more pluralistic. That's why I cannot say is not, in terms of, from a legal point of view, a more consolidated democratic situation, but it was more pluralistic. Of course, there was during this period also, before the 2008 crisis, a period of economic prosperity, increased prosperity. The growth rates in Ukraine were of the level of 7%, which is quite an important growth rate. Of course, the country came from a recession after the collapse of the Soviet Union, about some say 50% of contraction, and therefore it is normal that once the situation stabilizes that the country should grow. But there was indeed also economic development and growth, which demonstrates that despite of this apparent anarchy, there was an improved, let's say, economic situation, which therefore brings more opportunities to the citizen. The 2008 global economic crisis hit Ukraine particularly hard. And it hit Ukraine particularly hard because Ukraine still has today basically the same economic legacy from the Soviet Union. It has 40% of its export depend on steel, the big steel mills that exist, raw materials like coal and iron, fertilizers, which are made possible by cheap gas, which I consider to be the opium of Ukraine, the cheap gas, and therefore Ukraine agricultural, but not a sophisticated agriculture, and certainly not an agro-industrial base, which made Ukraine very vulnerable to these external changes that took place. Suddenly, the few products that Ukraine produced were no longer required in the market, which demonstrated that what has happened in Ukraine in the post-Soviet time is the transferring of ownership of these state assets from the state in the communist days to some businessmen who today dominate the economic landscape in the country. But competition, attraction of foreign investment, facilitating, encouraging the diversification of the economy. This has not happened. Has not happened then, it is not happening now. And therefore, we have today a vertical power, as it is called, where, let's say, we, from the election of the president, and I would like to recall that when President Yanukovych was elected, there was a lot of anxiety among the its rank and file that the European Union and the West in general were going to take sides against him in favor of Mrs. Tymoshenko because he was perceived as a pro-Russian. Of course, this has not happened. I have been myself involved in monitoring and following this process in March of 2010, and there was indeed a lot of nervousness on its ranks, and we received a lot of encouragement from Mrs. Tymoshenko and her supporters to precisely judge already immediately who should lead Ukraine. And of course we have not entered into this game. There was a no deal, an OSCE election observation mission that had the mandate to monitor the elections, and we said we will abide by their conclusions and we will not be subject to any influence. And like this, President Yanukovych was elected. He was immediately recognized by the European Union and the West in general, and he has expressed this objective orientation to continue the process of European integration, which we very much welcome. And therefore, these negotiations proceeded. We have seen also throughout this period a number of changes in very sensitive, let's say, political developments, which have not drawn the attention neither inside Ukraine, where I believe things should, first of all, draw the attention, because after all, it is the Ukrainians and their people who have to react to its developments in its own country, but then also reactions from outside the country. I am recalling, for instance, that soon after the elections, a new majority was established in the parliament. I have given the example on several occasions that in democratic countries, like for instance in any European Union country or in America, you may have a president that is from one political orientation And you may have a parliament and a government that is from a different political orientation. And they have to coexist, is the French term called cohabitation. We have today in the United States a situation like that. President Obama does not control the Senate, does not control the Congress. It is the Republican Party. He is a Democrat and he has to live with this reality. It is impossible to create a majority if a president is elected in any of the European Union countries belonging, let's say, to a different political color from what is the majority political color in the parliament, and in a matter of days you have a new majority that has switched colors. This is unthinkable, and I think this illustrates the very peculiar democratic circumstances in Ukraine. Another development was the change of the constitution, which again, normally changes of constitution are of the competence of the parliaments in countries. And it should not be a constitutional court who, in a country where we know that the independence of the bodies of the judiciary does not give great confidence, have decided overnight that this constitution is no longer good. We bring the constitution from a few years back. This has been, let's say, an opinion about this has been expressed by the Venice Commission, which very clearly call this as a very unusual development and certainly not the way to proceed. There were then the local elections, which took place in October of last year. I think in some cities, I think Kharkov was one of them, these elections were very, how shall I put it, very...
Сфальсификован.
Я не могу так сказать.
Я не могу так сказать.
Я дипломат. Я могу.
Yes.
Я не буду больше говорить о этом вопросе.
You are right. You are
right. So these developments at the time were criticized by the European Union and by other, let's say, partners of Ukraine. And at that time, President Yanukovych himself recognized that indeed these elections were not a step forward in consolidating democracy, and he pledged to adopt an election code, which, by the way, is a recommendation that the ODIHR has made repeated times, which means that if you have an election code, you have election legislation that is there to stay. It's not for each next election you cook a new legislation that fits the interests of those who are at the moment, let's say, running the show. And this pledge was unfortunately not followed, because in the beginning of the year we have learned that a new process of drafting a new law for the next election is in the making, with a top-down decision on what is the system that should prevail. And the European Union was particularly concerned, because we have funded the development of this election code, which was last year in July submitted by the Rada to the Venice Commission and was considered a very good election code. Now this election code has been practically ignored and a new process has been developed. And of course, in the beginning of this year, we started with the developments on what was for a long time expressed in political language as political, perceived as politically motivated prosecutions of former members of the previous government. And of course, today there is less political, let's say, diplomatic or politically correct expressions. We talk much more about the fact that they are indeed politically motivated, and that we have seen a succession of different new cases coming up. And this brings me to the situation where we are now, which is precisely the theme of our discussion, the state of relations today. we have a situation where this government, these authorities, have over a year ago speeded up the process of negotiating of the trade and economic part of this agreement, which was dragging for a long time without any progress, which is good news, we welcome that, and with the commitment to complete these negotiations by the end of this year, which means it will have to be in very few weeks, which we welcome, with the simultaneous development of some concerns that have now spilled over the borders of Ukraine. The cases of these trials, as you know, they are hitting headlines and newspapers from America to throughout Europe. And of course, the various yellow signals that I have mentioned about the democratic evolution in Ukraine, which were kept within the borders of Ukraine, now they have spilled over. And this problem and these issues became too obvious. And we are in a situation where the European Union is still committed to complete these negotiations, the Ukrainian authorities as well, and we look forward that this process will be completed. We call it technical negotiations. Once these negotiations are completed, there will be what is called an initialing, let's say the process is finished, and then we have to move to the process of proper signing and ratification, which means in terms of calendar, the process and the timing that takes within the European Union to for the member states, which are 27, to give a mandate to sign these agreements can lead to the signing around May, June of next year. From then on, it would start the process of ratification by all the parliaments of Ukraine, of course, and all the states of the European Union, plus the European Parliament. Only after this process is achieved, the agreement is fully in force. And therefore, we say that for us, the finishing of negotiation is not the end of the process, it's the beginning of the real process. But we hope that there will be a real process next year, because, as I was saying, if these issues are not, let's say, tackled, the positions, it will be quite difficult to have 27 states in the European Union unanimously accepting to sign this agreement, plus 27 parliaments, plus the European Parliament also. Because next year's election is also a very important barometer, because if you have elections in October of next year, when, if all goes well, the parliaments are ratifying these agreements, and you see that the elections in Ukraine are not going to be, let's say, what we expect, what I normally say, all the countries who went through democratization in the European Union, after 1-2 years, they already reached the stage where there is an election, at 7 o'clock, the polls are finished, and everybody knows the results. The loser congratulates the winner congratulates the winner and the loser, and we say now we are going to work for the sake of all the citizens for the next 4 or 5 years. If we don't have a similar situation in Ukraine next year, I think if we have situations like have existed in the past, I think it will have an impact in this process. Therefore, to conclude, before I open the floor for questions, I would like to say that we have made progress. We are close to completing a very important period. We hope that the concerns that we have been expressing will be taken into due account, so that this process is not going to be disturbed by some events in the future. Thank you very much.